Good afternoon, everyone. How was lunch? How was lunch? Good? Yeah. So we'll get going. I know we are almost on the hour, 2 o'clock. So my name is Ashish Mehdirathra. Quick introduction. So I've been in the industry for quite some time, almost 2 decades. Been doing Agile for more than 10-12 years now. But I still am learning every day, and I'm here to share some of my learning with you guys. And so feel free to help me along my journey, right? So the topic for today that we are presenting here is the Agile Balance Scorecard. So anybody who's familiar with the Balance Scorecard, a quick show of hands. 1, 2, 3, 4. Great, guys. Okay. So I think you guys can help me along with whatever is your experience along that journey, right? And I'll look forward to any feedback that you have, maybe in the presentation or post the presentation. All right. So let's get going. So how many of you are working in companies which are now doing Agile? You're in the conference here, right? All right. So I assume everybody's going to raise their hand, right? Okay. But as we're doing Agile in your organization, do you think that the whole business itself is becoming Agile, or are you struggling in some, running into some barriers? Are there anything stopping that journey? Anybody? Yes?
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, give us some insight if you can.
So I work with GE.
Yeah.
GE is a very large company.
Yeah.
And over the years, whatever process we have,
yeah,
they have all been built.
Yeah.
To be with lots of muscles, lots of flesh, everything, and leaning it,
yeah,
to become agile is, yeah, not at all an easy job.
Yeah. So you have so many things to work out,
exactly,
as a structure, titles, and everything all around it.
So be it process, be it the way people are organized,
yeah,
there are multiple challenges at,
right,
all of us.
Yeah.
So simple thing like putting together a cross-functional team,
yeah,
the way agile requires,
yeah,
is a challenge.
Is a challenge. Perfect. Perfect. Any other example? Anybody else wants to highlight anything that they're running into? Okay, so let's get going. I just wanted to set the expectations here, okay? Before I begin, just a quick disclaimer from my side. So all these opinions are mine, okay? So please don't relate back to anything to my employer, okay? All right, so all of us are in an enterprise, right? All of you are working for an organization. So how many of you know what's the vision, mission, and the strategy for your organization? Great, right? So this is practically what most of the organizations are. As a big enterprise, you will find, and the gentleman just said, one of the big organizations, you will definitely have all these things, mission, vision, goals, values, right? And then you have all these strategies to go along with it, right? But the idea is, within that organization, how much of that strategy or that vision or mission is being translated when you actually come down to the ground level, right? So that's the question we are going to answer and ask ourselves in this session today, okay? So the CEO says in his big board meeting and in front of the shareholders and in front of the employee town halls, right? How many of you are in a town hall, right? Right? Practically everybody, right? So you say, hey, what's our strategy? And he lays down this big 4 bullet points with a lot of fancy graphic and the color coming in, right? And he says, guys, this is our strategy. We got to beat this competitor, and we got to increase our revenue by 20% this year and maybe 60% next year. So that's our strategy. For that, what do we need to do? And he lays down a list of things, right? But then you again ask yourself the same question. Does the guy who's writing that piece of code, is he listening even in the town hall? Or is he just, how many of you have seen that? Okay. What's the latest WhatsApp message coming in, right? Okay, so how's that translating down to that level? And so the question is, when the CEO says, I wanted to go north, right? I wanted to go this way. Right, we have to beat this competitor. We have to make sure we wipe out this competitor. Or in other cases, we just want to say, I want to protect my current product line and grow my profit margins, right? So that's what the CEO language is, right? But is the guy who's writing that Java code or the .NET code, is he listening even on that? So you're having those barriers and those gaps in that business speak versus the technology speak, right? And that's what you want to look for and bring forward. And that's where we say, so do you know, as a CEO, hey, I laid out this strategy, but what is actually happening? Are we going to achieve that milestone that I laid out in my strategy in the next 3 months, in the next 6 months, and the next 1 year? Are we going to meet that or not? So you really don't know, right? So just to give you some statistics, so the strategy to execution, 90% of strategies fail. And this is a research done by Dr. Kotter. And the reason for that, the 95% failure is because of failed execution. It is not that the strategy is wrong, but just that the execution itself was either missing or incorrect, or the whole translation of the strategy itself didn't percolate down. So the communication gap is so strong that you never know where you're running. You're running in circles, you're going right, you're going left, and you're always being wondering at the top level, whether it's a CEO, I'm saying, or even at your program levels, or even at a, if you're a big project, you'll have maybe, let's say, multiple hierarchies. You really don't know what's happening on the ground. And that's where we say we want to measure, and the balanced scorecard comes in. So I'm just saying, laying down a little foundation here where you say, how can I translate from a strategy down to the ground level, okay? And therefore, this, you'll have a strategy map typically, right in the center you can see, which would translate the whole overall strategy into four different dimensions, right? And each of these dimensions have within them an equal weight. You can then divide the strategy for, let's say, a financial measurement. You may say, I want to grow my revenue by 20%, as simple as that. For customers, I say, I want to acquire new customers at the rate of 20% growth rate or 30% growth rate from my current baseline. In terms of my internal business process, I may say, I want to be able to build this new, I want to build thought leadership in this new technology. I want to be able to reduce my capability or the cycle time that I have in my new product pipeline delivery, right? So all that comes under your business processes. And in terms of the learning, again, you are asking the question again, what can I deliver with my current team today? I know, but what about the future? Can I meet the future, the competition, the changes coming in the market? So those are the questions you're asking and translating around this balanced scorecard, okay? And each one of these will come from the overall strategy. And you say, okay, here are my objectives, this is my measurements, and these are the initiatives I'm going to take, okay? So that's how you will break it down. And those initiatives will then percolate down to the ground, right? But then again, the question is, we just said we're all here for this Agile conference, right? And the balanced scorecard still holds good, right? So are you still going with the old balanced scorecard, right? Possibly, yes. But do you need to incorporate some new elements? The world has changed. We are following a certain methodology earlier. Now we are following this Agile methodology. There are certain parameters which are changing. The way we work is changing. The way we interact with you are changing. The challenges we have are changing, right, every day. So you still need to then ask yourself the question again, what is going to happen next? So everything is changing, right? Anybody who disagrees? Right? Not even a single guy, right? So everything is changing every day, right? The speed at which you get the information in is changing, right? And the amount and the velocity of information is changing, right? Everything around it. So what do you do, right? So how many are music fans here? Great. So you guys play with the equalizer anytime? Graphic equalizer, right? So what does it allow you to do, sir? If you can help me along, what does an equalizer allow you to do? Yeah. Anybody?
Adjust enhances.
Yeah, so it enhances the signals, right? So either you can boost it up or boost it down, right? So this is what we are saying here, that so you have a device which can really change, right, and give you the result that you want, exactly, right? So I can change this graphic equalizer setting and I'll get the frequency signal changing accordingly, right? So the idea is, now we have this capability with not just the balance scorecard, but I can now change my ground level actions based on this new agile balance scorecard. Okay, so that's what we are saying here. So keep the existing balance scorecard, but you can always go and modify it or append to it or extend it, whatever you want to call it, and use additional capabilities which we are now in this new model of agility. It's business agility, right? And business agility is about responding to change, to the competition, to the needs of the business, right? To protect and nurture your strategy, right? So that's what we are saying here. So the four dimensions I'll be talking about is the business values, and I think you heard Venkat talk a lot about business value early on, right? So that's what you're caring for all the time as one of the dimensions, right? The other thing you're looking at is the end user. Of course, the business is going to make money, but not at the cost of the end user, right? So you really want the end user orientation to come down to your team, to every engineer in your team, right? And then the operational excellence, so which is all about how quickly you deliver, with how do you have too much waste in your system? And that's where we'll talk about the operational excellence, right? And finally, the future orientation, which is linked back to the learning side of the world, right? And the learning is, how do you orient yourself or build your capabilities, right? So we'll quickly take a quick dive in each one of those. So one of the key parameters you can always measure, and this is true for any company, whether it's a product company mostly or services, how many releases you're making for either for yourself or for your clients, right? So you can always add this metric in your agile balance scorecard and say, guys, did I make just one release? And I know there are companies, and there are still companies who take 18 months to make a release. So you can always say how many releases I'm making in this year. Or you can, if you have more releases, you can say a quarter level each. How many features per release? So that's a simple metric to measure, right? All of you have product managers or clients who are giving you requirements in terms of features. We are all coming from that feature-driven development or the FRD, right? You have feature specifications, like we're talking about 100-page design. How many of you have seen like 300-page, even 500-page featured documents, right? I've seen those. Okay. So the idea is you have a feature is still existing in the world. Even in this new model of Agile, we still have a feature. We break it down into stories, but you can always count the features, right? So the features are always there for you to look at. Of course, the product backlog, and I say product in this case, but you could go it at a higher level and say, from a broad, if I have a portfolio of products, I can look at my portfolio burn down even, right? So you can say, within my portfolio, I may have multiple product lines, and each product line may have a certain burn down itself, right? So that is a key metric to measure in your orientation here for the business value. Technical debt, so you don't want to hide this away in some closet. We all know, anybody who says I don't have technical debt or my code is as good as it can be, I don't have any bugs in that, and I don't want to rewrite it, right? So we all know that it exists, right? So either you can shy away from it or be open about it and honest and tell business, guys, we have this debt in our technology world. We have to take care of it. If we don't take care in the short term, we'll be bitten in the long term, right? So that's a key thing you can always focus on and highlight and have that conversation with the business. Last item, and there are many more, but this is just a quick summary here. So the product flexibility, I'll just take that question. Let me just finish this. So the product flexibility is about how you can have, let's say I cater to multiple segments, right? I have the enterprise segment, high premium, I have a mid-market segment, and then I have a smaller segment, which is your, let's say, folks who don't have much money and only they sold it for a transaction-based product line, right? So how flexible is your product? Can you meet those challenges in terms of your delivery capability? So that again is your business value to the overall as a metric, right, sir?
I just wanted to check, you know, aren't like these metrics, major releases per quarter and features per release, also part of the traditional scorecard, balance scorecard, or are they more like just, you know, part of the agile scorecard?
So I didn't, we are not saying that these are not part of the traditional scorecard, right? What we are saying is that the product backlog burned down. So those are new things, right? And you can always design your scorecard up to you. So every organization has a different level of metric that they want to capture. Yeah. Okay. All right. We'll move on to the user orientation. So net promoter score is another key metric which you will always look at. Net promoter score is looking at what is the, if you buy this product from me, how loyal or how much loyalty you have to my product, and will you recommend my product to another person, right? So it's as simple as that. So you will always get that feedback from your VOC scores. I'm sure you all have support organizations. You can always reach out to them and find out what is my net NPS or net promoter scores. Another simple question to ask is how many calls do I get in terms of my support, right? It's as simple as that. So you all will have some support lines, right? A support team who's working on the product line in terms of the maintaining and sustaining the product line. So you can always ask how many service calls are. And that, the whole question is to ask is what is the trend? Not just that number, but is it trending down? And that's where you're saying my scorecard is improving, right? That is the key thing to ask. Again, the cycle time for the service. So if I pick up the phone today and I say, guys, I have a problem with this product, can you fix it for me? Now the whole cycle it takes for you to deliver, let it run through your product manager, down to the team, who then fix it, it goes to the testing, whatever, and comes back as a patch to be delivered. What is that cycle time, right, for that service call, right? So that is one of the other key metrics you will always want to look at in terms of the user orientation, right? Customer survey response percentage. So that's another one in terms of just the fact that customer are responding. You sent out surveys to, let's say, 1 lakh customers, but maybe just a couple of hundred responded back. That itself is an indication for you that how engaged your customers are, right? But if you get a good response rate, that definitely means something for you. So those are just some leading indicators for you to look at when you talk about user orientation, right? And of course, this is a standard one from a traditional scorecard. You will definitely look at some of those things like how many defects you escape finally into production, right? As simple as that. And if you want to introduce these stages, if you have those alpha, beta stages in your product release lifecycle, you can always capture those also. Okay. We come to operational excellence. So this is about how you as a unit or a business deliver things, how quickly you deliver things, what is the amount of waste you have in your cycle. And this will capture some of these items. You can always drill it down to number of features. If you have those metrics, if you are capturing those metrics, go down to per release versus per developer if you want to go to that level. You could always look at how many projects were completed within a certain duration which was planned earlier. So I've just put number here, plus minus 2 sprints, and that is an indication, but you can always flex it based on your organization, let's say past history, or your capability where you want to run it. Okay. Field issue resolution again. So how quickly you are resolving the issues which were reported from the field. And I've just given some indication of 30 days, right? So that's like within 30 days, how many issues you were able to get back to the customers, right? This is coming from your internal teams who are doing those continuous integration, continuous deployment, and continuous testing, which is happening throughout your SDLC cycle, right? So you'll capture the test passing, right? How much percentage of it is passing, how many builds are passing, and you can build those scorecards across the project, across your portfolio, and even across the organization, right? And of course, this is the last bit, but the most important one, the cycle time. The cycle time is all about the end-to-end delivery, and you can always spot the opportunities which are there for you to remove that waste. So I could be having waste if I just hand off my stuff. So I don't know if you have a big integration test team, right, or verification and validation test team, right, and you hand off the stuff at the end and they do the whole thing, right? Which will take, let's say, 3 months for them to merge and consolidate, right? So is that a waste? What is the value add for the customer in that sense, right? So you have to ask those tough questions internally and say, what is our cycle time and can we reduce all that? Okay, so that's all about the operational excellence. Future orientation. So this is about your learnings for your team, right? And many companies do this engagement scores, just like you do it for your customers outside, you do engagement scores internally. You talk up to your employees and say, guys, what's working? Are we doing good? The policies that we have, the reward structure, the compensation structure, and all those things, the whole package that we offer you, not just from the monetary, but from the work environment, the culture that you have in the company, and that translates into your engagement score, okay? So it's a key metric for you to make sure that you're ready for your future, that your teams are ready, right? Another important thing is the competency. So I think Venkat did talk about so the cost of language, right? The cost of changing the language. So if you are working in Java today, and I ask you to work in .NET tomorrow, cost is extremely high, right? So, but you need to be ready for the future because how many languages are there today? I remember 10 years back, there were probably like 50, maybe 100, but then today you'll have thousands of languages. Every day, every week, you'll have a new language coming up, right? So are you ready to work? Is your team ready? Do you have the competency to work in that, right? And not just languages, I'm just giving an example. It could be any tool, anything else in the ability to talk to the global audience from a communication skills perspective, right? Training us, and that's a key metric, which may already be measured again in a current scorecard, possibly in a balanced scorecard, but you really want to put it right up front in this kind of a scorecard also because you really want to invest in your people all the time. The other thing is about the cross-functional team, right? So I'm sure some of you must have a DBA group separate, and we heard the architect, the PowerPoint architect, right? We heard that. So you will have the architecture group separate, you will have some performance testing group separate, and a security group separate, right? So can you make a cross-functional team where each one of these guys are available for delivering that value, business value during that sprint or iteration, right? So those are the things you want to look for. If you can create those teams, and then you can simply go and measure them and say, I'm improving my scorecard accordingly. Okay, so that's the overall quick summary of the scorecard. But I just wanted to add some more, and you can always go back and say, guys, I can use it in whichever way I want. So we just had an initial conversation about the number of roles you have, right? How many titles you have, right? Do you have 4-layer hierarchy or 40-layer hierarchy, right? As simple as that. And if your top management or senior management is aware of it, and can they, or are they even striving to look at that? Okay, so those are the questions to ask, right? How many rules? So we have seen some companies whose HR policy documents are this big. I'm sure some folks in this room would also agree. How many policy documents you have, right? Anybody who says they have a HR policy of 2 pages? Excellent. I'd like to know the name of your company, sir.
Mock me.
Okay, great. So that's what we are all aiming for here when I say that the number of rules you have, which means that you're trying to build trust in your employees. You trust your employees, and you're not saying, guys, here's a rule book for you for every step that you take in the office. It's a simple indication for you to look at and say, how is it contributing to my scorecard? Okay. Time to value. Anybody want to help me on that? Time to value? So it's value when the customer sees the value. That's what it means, right? So I can always go ahead and say, guys, here's I've released my software and let me go to a release party in my team, right? But did the customer install the software and use it at that point in time? No, right? Most probably no, unless it's a hosted application probably. But most of the time, you will find there will be a gap between the actual deployment of the software, right? You will have some folks, the services group or somebody, who will go and deploy the software. Even then, the customer may not use it, right? He may just let it be. Only when he starts to use it is what you're saying is your time to value. So can you shorten that whole time, right? Not just from a time to release, time to deployment, but the time to value. Okay, so that's a key question to ask yourself, okay? And in your groups. Another metric could be in terms of, we all work with all the third party components. We have suppliers, not in the traditional manufacturing sense, but we use third party libraries. We work with sometimes vendors who create these third party components, right? So how many partnerships are you making? And if that is a key metric from a strategy point of view, that we need to expand or maybe lower our cost by having strategic partnerships. So that could be translated down to how many partnerships you have and then the quality of those partnerships. Okay. So customer-driven innovation. So in this new model, we have this great flexibility of talking to customers, right? So whether we talk it every 2 weeks or you have some other form of communication, whether it's a council, customer council, or you work through your beta programs. So there are different avenues which probably were not there in the earlier model, right? So now you have this customer on site who's ready to talk with the team. The customer mindset has changed, right? So simple thing, how can you collaborate with the customer to create new things which the customer really wants? And again, you want to know the domain. You already know the languages or the technology side of the world, right? But can you work out the problem that the customer is facing, but he's not really told you even that he's facing? Can you go to that level, right? So those are the things you want to look at and say, how many such innovations can I drive through my organization and make it part of that scorecard, okay? So I think I'll probably pretty much done with the overall theme. Any questions till now? So I'll give you some examples, and again, this is of a, let's say, a company which is in a growth phase, right? And they are looking at, I want to grow my market share, right? So what do you guys think? I'll ask you guys to give me some examples here. Yeah, help me along. Anybody? For increasing my business value? How can you increase business value? If I want to increase my market share, that's my strategic goal.
More customers.
More customers? Get more customers. Yeah?
Be more productive.
Sorry?
Be more productive.
Be more productive. We're talking about business value. That would probably be in one of the other scorecards. Yeah. The operational side of the world.
More revenue.
More revenue. Yeah. So that's a goal. What will you measure in terms of one of the metrics?
Better product.
Customer satisfaction. Yeah. Anybody else?
Better defect-free product.
Defect-free product. Yeah. Yeah. So I would. So we are talking at the business value scorecard for now. Yeah. And that would fall in one of the quality parameters, that how the quality is good or bad for the customer. Yeah. Sorry?
Fortunately, on different verticals.
Different verticals. Yeah?
Okay. Be first in the market, probably.
Be the first in the market. Yeah, definitely, definitely. Yeah. So that's how you're delivering business value. So all of those are correct. I've just put down some of the thoughts again that you want the how many features or releases that you're adding to the product. That's where you're saying it is about the business value side of the world. We talked about the user orientation, and I think some of you covered those points again, but anybody wants to add anything else on the this part of the world? User orientation is looking at the end user. Yeah.
User experience.
Yeah, that's a key thing. I think as we are evolving and getting to know more things, with the customer and collaborating more in this new model? Yes, definitely. Yeah. Anybody from this side? Okay. So again, user orientation. Example is a net promoter score is a basic example for that, right? You users will tell you whether they'll recommend your product to the other guy or not. And I've just put another one, which is your response percentage, as simple as that. Right? And these are just examples. You can fill in your own metrics. Operational excellence, I think you did mention.
Productivity.
The productivity side of the world.
Quality,
yeah?
Measurements.
Can you be louder, sir?
Yep. Quality measurements, like
quality measurements, yeah. Anybody else? Yeah. Reducing the overheads, yeah, basically removing the waste, right? Yeah, okay. So I've added features per developer, yeah. So that is extremely valid. But just keep in mind the strategy is to increase the market share. Okay, so that's where we are focusing on mostly, right? And market share we are saying will increase when you delight the customers, right? You will be able to give them new features. It's like Hyundai is coming out with new car models every third month, let's say, right? And so you're hooked on to Hyundai either to upgrade or to see what's coming next. I'm just giving a hypothetical example here, right? So it's about growing your market share all the time. That's the overall strategy and how you're translating that into the metrics that you want to capture in the scorecard. Okay. The last one on the future orientation. Yeah?
Cross-functional
teams, yeah,
innovation.
Definitely. Yeah,
innovation.
Innovation, customer-driven, yeah.
Trainings,
yeah, definitely, yeah. Okay, right on the money there. So we're building new competencies, and these are again my limited examples I've given you here. The idea is, so if you look at this whole thing, you can. The CEO is talking about growing the market share, right? And now you can divide it into these quadrants and say, guys, this is what we are aiming for, and start to assign those scores based on your current baseline, current competency, and say, in the next few quarters, this is what we are aiming for, okay? So that's how you can start building your scorecards and turning around your teams to focus on those priorities, okay? Like I said, half the time the problem is with the execution of the strategy, right? So now when you have a clear goal, and if I may ask, so if you have your performance appraisals, I'm sure everybody does, right? So half the time the question to ask to be, which is not clear, is what were my goals, right? I never knew my goals, right? My boss never told me my goals, and it will happen to me all the time, right? So now you have a clear indication of the goals that your boss is asking, and his boss is asking, and the boss's boss is asking, right? Which is linked straight to the overall strategy for the organization, okay? We'll take one last example. So this is about the stability. So you don't want to grow the market share. You want the existing product to run smoothly, okay? So that's, let's say your CEO has given the strategy here. So what do you guys think? Fill in the metrics. Who wants to do? Yes, sir, this side. What will come in business value? Anything that comes to mind? Nothing? Okay. So basically you're looking at burning down the technical debt. That's the key thing, right? You want, let's say you had major performance issues coming from the field. The product is not stable. Every time as a user I use it, it just crashes. And you are getting hundreds and hundreds of service calls every day. You're getting escalations every day, right? Has it happened to anybody? Right? I'm sure it must have, right? You get escalations, how do you kill them? You definitely go back to the team and ask, guys, what's the problem? And they say, guys, we have this huge mountain of technical debt. Just because the last release was rushed, we had to make this quick hack, quick fix, and that has resulted in this escalation. And it has impacted thousands of customers, correct? So you really want to burn down that technical debt, and that's one of your scorecard metrics, right? And that ties to the CEO's agenda of stability, right? So you can see we are speaking two languages now, right? You are speaking the CEO's agenda, which is talking about the stability program, right? And here we are saying we are going to fix the technical debt, right? And that is adding to the overall business value, okay? Flexibility again. So I may want to introduce flexibility in my product for a certain category of customers. I may say these features are high performance features and introduce, let's say, some caveats in the lower performing features for other segment of customers. So can I do that with my product? If not, I want to go in that direction probably, correct? So just a few examples for you to think about. User orientation, so again, anybody for this? Cycle time, yeah? User orientation, what's the user going to say?
Feedback,
right? Service calls, as simple as that. So is my trend declining for service calls or not? Maybe last month I had 1,000 service calls per day, and this month I'm getting only 10 service calls per day. So that's probably my goal also, which was back to the earlier baseline. Okay. And service call cycle time, that's what you guys said. So that's exactly right, that you want to measure how much time it is taking for me to get those stability fixes out in the field, correct? Okay, I think this one came up, operational excellence. So I put up field issue resolution, right? And cycle time and waste removal, right? Everybody on board with this? Because you're asking the stability of the product in this case, right? You're trying to say, I want the resolution numbers to go down, the cycle time and the waste to be removed. And finally, future orientation. Yep, anyone?
Cross-functional
teams. Maybe you have a scenario where your development is all good, but your deployment is failing, right? Your deployment teams are probably messing some things up, and maybe because just the configuration is not communicated properly, correct? So you will definitely want those teams to collaborate together and have a common outcome, which is the stability of the product, right? Cross-functional teams, okay? So I think that pretty much is summing up what I have. So I would encourage you guys to go and look at your organizations, look at your challenges, look at your strategy, right? Maybe you want to go back and ask, or maybe not ask if you are already the CEO here, or you want to read up what your CEO has said in the last town hall as a strategy, right? And then see, can you build a scorecard from that strategy, or has the CEO given you some directions, and there are some strategic programs which are already running based on that strategy, right? And what are the key metrics that you have, and then translate it down to your team, right? As to guys, why we are doing this is because it is linked to this strategy of higher growth or a stable product, right? We want our customer calls to go down so that our NPS scores go up and we make more margins, right? That's why your work is important, so that you can reduce the technical debt, which is pretty high right now. So you can frame that conversation now using those scorecards, right? If you're a manager managing a portfolio of programs, you can use these scorecards then to manage and say, this portfolio or this program is going in the right direction as per the strategic alignment, right? So the key thing is also how aligned you are to the strategy. Like I think Venkat did mention, I can always work in the latest features of Java just because I want to, but is it aligning to the overall strategy of the company, right? Maybe the strategy is to go and fix those defects right now, which are impacting the stability, correct? So you can always build those metrics and translate it down to the ground level, and ultimately improve the execution, which is the key number one indicator of why strategies fail, right? So hopefully you guys can bring it the 95% of failure of the strategy right, and reduce that percentage using the scorecards. So I think I'll rest it here. And any questions? I can take. Yeah.
Ashish, the question that I wanted to ask is, this balanced scorecard seems to give a perspective of an enterprise under four different dimensions.
Yeah.
Is there an example of a company in the software world,
yeah,
which is using this to drive either their growth phase or the maturity phase that you have come across?
Yeah.
And what are the challenges that they encountered when they looked to adopt this kind of metrics?
Yeah, so these are my thoughts. Okay. So I have not been able to interact with any organization who's actually gone in this direction. Okay. So, but there are, of course, the current balanced scorecard programs, they will include some of these metrics. But what I'm saying today is that we want to include some of these metrics which are coming from our day-to-day practices that we do as delivery organizations. From the changes happening around due to the agile model of working that we are having.
Right.
And to work around these barriers that you are facing now, we in the industry are facing versus where it is the hierarchy or the roles, we need to include these metrics in that scorecard. It's like enriching those scorecards which are existing, right, and bring this additional insight into them, right, so that you can make a better informed decision. Yeah. Any other question?
So product flexibility, how can you measure that?
So product flexibility is like, so if I have a product and I have, it is a, let's say, a very high-end product today, right? I cater only to the enterprise segment and it requires, let's say, 10 service guys to go and install it, and it takes a 3-month or a 6-month cycle to just to go make it go live. Okay, let's assume that is a scenario. But can I make it flexible in the sense that can I break it down where it can be consumed by, let's say, a lower segment of the market? Let's say, can I make it from an enterprise deployed software on-site to a hosted solution, which is a transaction-based? Okay, the core guts of the software remain the same, right? But I can scale it up or down based on the needs of the customers. Okay, that's what I meant by flexibility. So if you have that flexibility, then you can provide more business value, right? So the business can now go out and sell this product and this as a service now, right? So rather than just selling it as a infrastructure or as a complete shrink wrap product, I can start using it as a service and derive more revenue. Okay, so it's contributing to my revenue percentage. I can grow my revenue. So that could be part of your overall strategy. So as an engineering team, you may want to look at how much flexibility I have today. If not, how can I make it more flexible? Okay. Any last questions? All right, guys. Thanks for your time. I'll be around if you want to catch me again. Thank you very much.